listening to CLNS Media, powered by betonline.ag. Go to clnsmedia.com/roll. Use our promo code CLNS50 for 50% off your first deposit.
Bleeding purple and gold from the heart of Los Angeles, this is the LakersNation.com podcast with your host, Trevor Lane.
Hello, Lakers Nation. Welcome back to another show. Guys, as always, we're powered by CLNS Media and LakersNation.com, your home for everything Lakers. Tons going on. The NBA Finals are about to start. We finally have an idea of who's in them. It's going to be the Toronto Raptors against the Golden State Warriors. We'll chat about that a little bit, and we'll chat a lot about your Los Angeles Lakers and what they have coming up this offseason. Tons of key decisions coming up that we're going to break down here today. And to help me out with all of that is Keith Smith from Yahoo, Real GM, and Celtics Blog. Keith, thanks so much for hopping on once again.
Absolutely. Thanks for having me. I love, you know, breaking it down with you, and it's going to be another interesting summer for the Lakers, so I'm excited to get into it.
Always fascinating stuff going on in the world of the Los Angeles Lakers. Before we dive into it, of course, guys, quick shout out. Happy Memorial Day to all the vets out there, and appreciate all the sacrifices that everyone has made for our country. So we need to make sure that we do mention that. Hopefully all of you are having a fun and safe Memorial Day weekend. And let's talk a little bit of basketball. So first of all, let's talk about this real quick. Toronto Raptors versus Golden State Warriors. Are you surprised, Keith, that we wind up with the Raptors in the end?
I am a little, especially with the Bucks taking the first two games of that series. I thought Toronto, the likelihood of them being able to win four out of five was pretty small. Never mind winning four in a row. But the Raptors really found some stuff that worked. Defensively, I thought they did a really good job getting after the offensive glass as well. And then they had just enough scoring. It helps when Fred VanVleet starts playing like the all-time greatest shooter we've ever seen. You know, I think that was a key too. But, you know, the Raptors bench stepped up big. And, you know, and Toronto's here. And I'm excited. I think this has a chance to be a pretty good, compelling finals. It's something different for the first time in 4 years, so we'll take that as well.
I saw something out earlier today, and I don't have the tweet right in front of me, but it was mentioning Fred VanVleet and his 3-point shooting. I want to say he's like 14 of 17 or 15 of 17 or something over the last four games, and that's like an NBA playoffs record with over 15 shots taken. So incredible stuff there. You got to wonder if there's a regression to the mean coming in the next round, but we'll see. What do you think this does as far as Kawhi goes? A lot of people saying, oh, this means Kawhi staying in Toronto. I don't think it necessarily has a big bearing on his decision in any way. Of course, we don't know because Kawhi doesn't talk.
Yeah, that's it, right? And that's the thing. And I think that kind of leads to what that's been a popular question is, you know, is making the finals enough for him to stay there? Do they have to win the finals? I do think if they win, it maybe makes it a little harder for him to walk away. But I think Kawhi's just a different kind of dude. You don't ask out of the Spurs unless you're a guy with a different mindset on the way things work. So right. I do think, you know, whatever he wants to do, he's going to do. You know, it doesn't matter what the position of the Raptors is, and, you know, good, bad, or indifferent. If he wants to be in, you know, California, he's going to sign with one of the Southern California teams, Clippers or Lakers, and go that direction. And I think that's, you know, regardless of what happens here in the finals.
So if you had to guess what's going to happen in the finals, what's your prediction? Who walks away with it?
I think it's going to be the Warriors, but I think it'll be Warriors in six. I think the Raptors can really challenge them. It's important. I think people were so used to the Warriors being the league's best team in the regular season. They don't have home court advantage for the first time in one of these runs, if I'm, you know, remembering that correctly. So I do think, you know, but that game six at home is going to be big. I think Raptors can get a couple off them. I think it'll be really competitive, especially if Kevin Durant is unable to make it back and play. But just the Warriors, you know, been there, done that. They know what the finals is like. They know that rhythm. It's one of the things that players talk about a lot is just all the extra media, the time of the games, and all those things being just very different from the way it is in the regular season. I think Golden State's just got that a little bit of an advantage, as well as obviously still being a really good basketball team as well.
I mean, look, the Raptors, I think their defense can keep them in the series. Certainly that's been their calling card. They've been such a good defensive team. They rotate on a string. It's really, really fun to watch. But at the same time, the Steph Draymond Green pick and roll has just been incredible for the Golden State Warriors. It's like that's been completely reignited. And then they've got, hey, this guy named Kevin Durant might be coming back here. And then also throw on top of that DeMarcus Cousins. I mean, are you kidding me? This team's getting to the finals and then you're getting DeMarcus Cousins and Kevin Durant coming back. That's a whole lot of talent to try to deal with.
Yeah, that's why my fantasy football league started barring trades, and you know, as we got close to the playoffs, because guys who were already good were loading up their teams, and we said, you know, we got to stop this because this isn't really fair. And that's what the Warriors feel like, is a real life version of that a little bit.
They're a cheat code, but that all could change this summer, and that's going to be the focal point of this show here, is talking about this summer and what things could look like. And I guess first we should start by talking about the draft. And that's, you know, the draft is going to come up in just a few weeks here. And I suppose you could argue that the draft maybe should be after free agency, and we can dig into that in a bit. But of course, Lakers fans were celebrating when they moved up from the 11th pick to the 4th pick in the draft. That's going to change the options that are out there. The other day, Corey Hansford and I broke down some of the big options. Of course, we broke down the big four, it was what it seems like. And that's Cam Reddish, DeAndre Hunter, Darius Garland, and Jarrett Culver as the four guys that are real options there for the Lakers at number 4. Seen a few rumors out there that the Knicks could take Jarrett Culver and pass on RJ Barrett. I think that's very unlikely, but who knows? Maybe that's something that's in the mix as well. But as much as we're celebrating, from a cap perspective, if you're looking at just maximizing your cap space for this summer, moving from the 11 to the 4 pick actually isn't necessarily a good thing, because the amount you're spending is going to go up a little bit, right, Keith?
Yeah, absolutely. It really changes the math by a pretty significant amount. The 11th pick had a cap hole, rookie cap hole, to just over $4 million, and the number 4 pick has a cap hole of just over $7 million. So you're going to go up by a considerable amount there, and that's, you know, something you really need to think about. That's, you know, going to be something, you know, that matters. That $3 million and change, you know, could make a difference for the Lakers. Now, there's also the questions of are they even going to keep the pick? Are they going to trade the pick? Does that matter? That's all true. You know, that's all fair and, you know, valid questions. So yeah, we'll ultimately see in the end where that all goes. But I do think it's something that maybe is being overlooked a little bit, that $3 million, that's going to come back to make a big difference. Now, they can get out of it easy enough if they need to, but that's if they need to.
So you'll have to refresh my memory on the rules here. As I recall, and this is off the top of my head, as of right now, that pick has zero value in terms of trade, in terms of cap. But once you select someone, that's when that cap hit comes in. So if they were to trade the pick, say they select somebody, let's say they take Jarrett Culver with the 4 pick, a few weeks go by, they didn't land anybody in free agency, then they go try to trade Jarrett Culver for something. Let's say they put him in a package for Bradley Beal. That's when he would then have that cap hit of whatever it is, the $7 million that we were just talking about, right?
Well, kind of, sort of. Okay. You're almost there. So when the pick itself, when there's no player attached to it, has zero value in trade as far as salary matching. Okay. You know, obviously it has great value being the number 4 pick in the draft. I want to be careful because someone will throw that back at me. You said the 4 pick isn't worth anything. You know, no, it's worth a lot in trade. But
we're
salary,
just talking about the numbers here.
That's it. Just math here. You know, so when you talk that, now you draft a guy, it still has zero in trade. What ends up happening is, until you sign the player, that's when his salary takes hold. But for the Lakers, as far as cap space, it has a cap hold attached to it, but you can't trade a cap hold. If that makes sense. Mm-hmm. So what did they say? $7 million or so.
Right.
That's going to be on the Lakers salary sheet as a $7 million cap hold. But if they sign the 4th pick, then the 4th pick and his salary go on the books as $7 million. Then at that point, you could trade them. But here's the kind of kicker with that. You have to wait 30 days after you sign them to trade a guy. That's the challenge. If we go back a few years to when LeBron James returned to Cleveland, remember Andrew Wiggins got traded for Kevin Love?
Yep.
But if you remember back, remember we all sat around like, oh yeah, Andrew Wiggins is a Cavalier for 30 days, because in order to match salary on Kevin Love, to bring him in the first place, they needed to include Wiggins at his salary number. So the Cavs signed him, waited the 30 days, traded him, and then that's when everything was, you know, oh hey, wow, look at that, traded Kevin Love to the Cavs, even though we all knew for 30 days. So that's where it gets a little confusing and a little bit tricky. Hopefully that cleaned it up a little bit.
Okay, that makes sense. That's what I was thinking of then, as far as the cap goes. And that reminded me why I was thinking there was some significance to when they signed him. It's because of the 120% rule. That's what was in my head. So, and you can correct me if I'm wrong here, but I remember the Lakers doing this with Julius Randle. Maybe they've changed this rule since then. But if you hold off on signing a guy, let's say you sign a guy, the cap hold will just be for what the number they expect it to be, right? But now the league can go, or the team can go up to 120% of what that number is. So if it's $7 million, they can actually sign him for a little bit more than that, and most teams usually do as kind of like a bonus to their rookies. But once you do that, then he's got that higher number for trade purposes. He's eating up a little bit more of your cap space, so that's why teams would have some incentive to hold off on actually signing a guy, because it keeps a little bit more money free on their books.
So that's actually changed now too.
Okay, so they've gotten rid of that rule. Okay, I thought they had done something with it, but I'm not up to date on all that.
Yeah, because part of what was happening was when teams were doing that whole, we're going to wait, we'll sign our rookies last. Mm-hmm. That was how kind of order of operations was, because you were trying to conserve that little bit of money. And, you know, as the rookie salaries rise, and, well, that extra 20%, that's not a little bit. That's a big chunk of money. So what the league did was said, there had been a study done, and I want to say it was 99.7% of first-round picks signed for 120% of the rookie scale. So the league and the Players Association said, this is stupid. It was also causing players to sit out and miss summer league because guys weren't signed to their contract. So they were like, well, I'm not going to play until I'm signed.
Right.
Well, as we all know, right, summer league's right as free agency kicks off on, used to be July 1st. Now it's going to be June 30th. Which, as an aside, I'm super excited about as an East Coaster.
I am too. Even here, even on the West Coast, I love that. And what it's up to what now? It's 6 Eastern time, right?
Yeah,
so 6 that's going to be 3 o'clock Pacific time for most of you guys who are listening to this. And I think that's going to be absolutely amazing, because I can remember writing stories at 2 a.m. Pacific time when news was breaking that people had signed. So, yeah, I can only imagine, as excited as I am, Keith, you've got to be just completely thrilled over on the East Coast.
Oh, my God. And being a Sunday this year and Monday being a work day. Yeah, I'm pretty pumped about that one. So but to go back to it. So the league closed down that loophole. The league and the Players Association and the latest collective bargaining agreement. Everybody counts now for the 120%. You could still sign them for as low as 80% of the first round salary slot, which never, ever happens. Right. It's happened only a couple of times that I can remember. It's even rare that guys even sign for as low as 100%. I think the last guy to sign for less than 120 was Andre Roberson when he signed with the Oklahoma City Thunder back in the day. And that was a kind of wink, wink of, we'll make this up to you on the back end in your next contract. And whether they did or didn't, that's, you know, your evaluation of Andre Roberson's, you know, salary that he's being paid currently. But to stay with it. So, yeah, so that is closed down. So that's $7 million. That sits on the Lakers' books as $7 million. That's what the number will be. It could change slightly as the cap settles. If it comes in a little below $109 million, which is the current projection, that number will go down slightly. If it comes in a little over $109 million, it'll go up just a little bit. But you're fair to guess it's going to be right around $7.1 million.
Okay, so that's great information to know. Now let's talk Lakers overall. So if they've got this money on the books that they weren't expecting, they were expecting to have the 11 pick, how does this change their total amount of cap space that's going to be available to chase free agents this summer?
Yeah, so as we were saying, it knocked about $3 million off it. So where I had the Lakers coming into the draft is I had them at about $35.5 million. Mm-hmm. Was where I had them, maybe in 35.6. Now I've got them projected to be at 32.5 is my projection for them. Down you know, just a little bit, but
That's the max, right?
Exactly. Yeah. That's the important little bit, because the max salary tiers for next year are projected at 27.25. That's the low tier. That's right. The 0-6. So that's the guys coming off their rookie deals. Then 32.7, that's the Kyrie Irving tier, if you will. That's his tier, guy kind of in the coming off his second contract. And then the max tier is $38.15 million. And this is all on $109 million projected cap. So that's the big tier there, is that $38 million. And that's where it starts to get a little tricky is, you know, So I've got the Lakers just shy of getting to that middle tier max, the Kyrie Irving tier maximum. Now, that's not so much that they'll get there if they need to. They'll find, you know, somebody to take on Isaac Bonga's deal or, you know, whatever the case is. But if they're going to get up to that $38 million, that, you know, the so-called, you know, super max tier or the highest max tier that you've got.
We're talking Kevin Durant.
Yeah, that's the Kevin Durant tier. Absolutely. Yeah. That's where you're going to have – they're going to have to move one of the – you know, Lonzo Ball contract, Brandon Ingram, you know, two out of Hart, Wagner, and Kuzma, something like that to get to that kind of money, because, you know, that's not there. And just so everybody knows what my projections are going into is I have the Lakers basically renouncing all of their free agents because there's really no reason to keep any of them on the books that they have. That's not to say they might not be interested in bringing some of those guys back, because I think there are a couple there. And then obviously, you know, so sorry for Jamario Jones and his family and that, but I think his contract was set up to be easily waived. So that leaves Ball, Bonga, Hart, Ingram, James, Kuzma, Wagner, and the fourth pick. That's all the money I've got on their books, and then the subsequent salary holds, as well as, let's not forget, $5 million for Luol Deng's stretched contract that's sitting out there as well.
Mm-hmm. So they've got that much money on the books. Gosh, that's... So that's where this fourth pick really hurts them, because they were pretty darn close to being right there for a Kevin Durant level max. That's that 10-year max. Yep. But guys like Jimmy Butler, guys like Kawhi Leonard, right, Klay Thompson, Kemba Walker, all of them fall in that tier two max. So they would still be close enough for that caliber of player. And for the Lakers' perspective, I think most fans are assuming that Kevin Durant, after his comments about the toxic environment around LeBron James, is probably not coming to the Lakers
anyway. Yeah, I think that's fair.
Okay.
I think that's probably a fair one. But it's Kevin Durant. He's, you know, who knows? Maybe he said that's enough for he is coming. You know, I don't know what to think. But to your bigger point, yeah, you're close enough there that, you know, in a guy like Isaac Bonga, that's the guy I look at. You could easily say to a team, hey, here's a second-round pick, two second-round picks, whatever the case is, you know, take this contract off our books, and most teams are going to be like, all right, yeah, no problem, we'll do that for you. Or, you know, or maybe you even look at it as, you know, hey, we're going to flip Josh Hart for something, or Mo Wagner for something there, to say, you know, hey, we're going to flip those guys, you know, with some other smaller salary. It's close enough at that point that you're going to make it happen if you need to.
Yeah, it's close enough to where, look, if Kevin Durant calls you up and says, hey, I want to be a Laker, you're going to say okay, and you're going to figure out a way to get it done. It's not an impossible task or anything like that. So let's say, Keith, let's say the stars align and everything works out the way the Lakers wanted to, and they get one of those tier two max guys. Let's assume Kevin Durant is off the board. He is going off to New York or wherever, right? And so you've got, let's say they get Jimmy Butler. Okay, Jimmy Butler signs with the Lakers. They are then basically out of cap room, but they would also need to build out a team. So what mechanisms would they have under the salary cap structure to then fill out the rest of their roster?
Yeah, that's a great question. This is where it really gets fun for me, because this is where I think it really becomes, this is where your front office is makes their hay, if you will. It matters to attract max guys and figure that out, but it's building out the rest of that roster. So the way I kind of approach it is, you've got LeBron and free agent X. Those are your big ticket guys. Then you've got this fourth pick. So there's another guy. And then to make it very easy on myself, I collectively call them the kids. You know, that's everybody left. So Ball, Ingram, Kuzma, Hart, Bonga, and Wagner. Those I just call them the kids. Now, you've got one of two things you can do. You could start spinning those guys off in trades. You know, do you package them all together and go get an Anthony Davis? Okay, but then that leaves you with James Davis and free agent X, in your case here, Jimmy Butler or Kyrie or whoever it is. And now you're really with, you got nothing else, right? That's it. That's the entirety of your roster. And last I checked, you need at least, you know, 12 guys.
That'll be ideal.
In the CBA, you actually need at least 14, is the way the rules work. So
is it 14? I'm sorry to interrupt here. So last I looked, there's an empty roster spot charge for up to 12, but you have to fill out your roster to 14 as of opening night. Is that right?
It's not as of opening night, but once the season starts, anytime you dip under 14, you have 2 weeks to get back to a 14th player. That's part of the protection, so that teams don't keep and sit on, you know, multiple open roster spots. Right. You know that you need to get back to a, you know, relatively full roster. It's also part of the protection in there, so when they agree to two-way contracts, the Players Association, thus the players and the agents, they don't want teams sitting with two-way guys and then leaving two, you know, roster spots open because you have the two-way guys in place. So the idea was to really give teams up to 17 guys that they could have on a roster, not to keep it at 15, but goofing around with the two-way deal. So hopefully that makes sense. So, yeah, so to your question, right, that leaves you with, you know, LeBron, free agent X, Jimmy Butler, whoever it is, and the kids. That's not bad, right? So there you are. Now you're filling out the roster in that situation with – you're going to have the room exception. So that's going to be value of – hold on. I'm going to look that up real quick. I should have it pulled up already. I apologize. Almost there. Of about $4.76 million. That can be split up. So you could go get one or two guys with that. And that could be, you know, the way you bring in guys, that limits you to a couple-year contract. And then after that, you're on to minimum exceptions. So that's veteran minimums, or you're on to, rookie minimum contracts. Now, this is where I look at it and I always say, all right, well, a team with LeBron and another, superstar player, yeah, you're going to get veterans that'll sign up to fill that out. They're not going to be the best guys in the world, but you're, we were talking about the Warriors a couple minutes ago. You're David West of the world and those kind of guys who are going to come in and fill it out. Or that's where, you start looking at it and say, geez, Brandon Ingram, we've got James and Butler now. And Brandon Ingram's, that $7.3 million salary, that could go a long way. Maybe we could get a couple rotation guys for that. And you start looking at teams, to say, all right, well where's a couple guys who make, maybe up as much as, $9 million or so salary matching together. Could we flip Ingram there because we've already kind of got our two wing spots locked in with James and Butler, or, whatever it is. If they go and get a point guard, if they get Kyrie, do you look at it and say, all right, Lonzo's $8.7 million. Well, that gets us, one or two good players there to fill out the rotation. So there's a lot of different ways you can go about it. But as far as straight signings, you're pretty limited to the room exception and then the veteran minimum or the minimum exception deals.
So they're going to have a tough task then once if they do land their max free agent that they've been setting up for, right? They've been planning for this for a while now. This was their plan in last summer's free agency. That's why you saw Rajon Rondo sign a 1-year deal, Lance Stephenson, JaVale McGee, Michael Beasley, all these guys, Kentavious Caldwell-Pope, all these players on expiring deals. So they would have this money to spend and they would go try to get this max player. But the downside of it is now if you do get a max player, you're going to be capped out or somewhat. You'll have the one exception, but you'll be able to go after a lower quality of player to fill in around, say, LeBron James and Jimmy Butler or Kemba Walker or Kyrie or whoever it is that they wind up going after. So that's where you've got Rob Pelinka and perhaps the Rambi now, Kurt Rambis and Linda Rambis and whoever else is involved in the Lakers front office. They'd be really showing their worth at that point if they can sign some of those big deals. You look at, say, Brook Lopez from last summer. Letting him go ended up being a big mistake for the Lakers and a big, big win for the Milwaukee Bucks, who almost went to the NBA Finals, partially due to the shooting and what he brought in there. So if you can find, you can still find talent for that amount of money, but you've got to be really smart about how you spend it. That's where you can't go and dump $4 million into a guy like Lance Stephenson. You've got to have a little bit more discipline and hopefully have the ability to close some of the higher level role players out there.
Yeah, absolutely. And because of the need of depth on the roster, that's where, maybe you can get a player who's, maybe you can get someone of, I like Lopez's, idea is someone of his talent range for the $4.7 million room exception. But you might be better off getting two guys for, $2.5 million almost each. You might be better off there, doing something like that because it becomes a question of, well, that one guy better be pretty good. And I know people love to say, in the playoffs, you only need 7 or 8 guys anyway, which is, is true to an extent, but you still got to play 82 games to get there.
Right.
And obviously we saw with the Lakers that was an issue this year. If you don't have all the injuries they have, they're probably in the mix right up until the final week of the season for a playoff spot, if not a playoff team. It's, the injuries are really what tanked them. And I love that you reference back to last year, right? I think when, let's go back to a year ago. I think when you and I did this type of conversation, it was all the same stuff. But what's different this time around is last year the Lakers had LeBron. Well, before they even had LeBron, they had they had almost or basically had two max salary slots. Now, because I've had this question come up to me is, well, why is it different from last year? Well, LeBron's taken up one of those now. He's already there. He's sitting in, on the books for $37.4 million next year. So he's on your books in one of the max salary slots. So now you've only got one to work with. Once that one is gone, that's it. Now, and then, you know, and I just wrote about this for Real GM in a piece that'll be coming out this week for the offseason preview. And I'm 100% on board with what they did last year of, all right, we're going to one-year deals. That's it. We're going to basically roll this thing over and fill out the roster as best we can. I don't know that you can do that another year of that, because I don't know that LeBron's going to be okay with that. I'm not sure, but I don't know that there's a better option if you don't get that max guy. I think you got to be smart and, you know, plan this thing for, all right, well, we're going to try to keep our flexibility open and just go forward with what we can do here.
Well, let me mention that real quick, because that's been one of my points too to Lakers fans is, look, if you don't get somebody this year, a lot of Lakers fans have said, oh, no big deal, go one-year deals again. Anthony Davis will sign as a free agent next summer in 2020. But here's the thing. You've got then Brandon Ingram needs a new contract. Mm-hmm. LeBron's making more. Lonzo Ball's salary goes up. Okay, you've got all these salaries that are increasing. And as a result, depending on what happens with the cap, if it stays fairly stagnant, if it stays at that 109, you no longer have that max salary slot open because salaries have risen to give to Anthony Davis. So there's the potential there that just rolling it over doesn't mean you have enough space next summer to go after somebody if you don't get someone right now.
No, you're spot on there. And just to put a little numbers behind that, Lonzo's on the books this year for $8.7 million. Next year, that jumps to $11 million. That's a big jump to $2.4 million. That's huge. That makes a difference. Even a guy like Josh Hart, $1.9 this year, $3.5 next year. Kyle Kuzma, $1.9 this year, $3.6 next year. LeBron, it's 37.4, but then that goes up to 39. But the big one is Ingram. Ingram's on the books for $7.3 million this year. Now, one of the other things, right, we talked about closing the loophole earlier. Another loophole the NBA closed in this most recent CBA, or the current CBA, I should say, is guys coming off rookie scale deals. They used to have these little tiny cap holds. This is how the Spurs did it with Kawhi, the Bulls with Jimmy Butler, the Pistons with Andre Drummond. They basically said, the guy's a restricted free agent. Don't offer him any kind of deal. We're going to match it anyway. And what that ends up doing is that is a tactic to scare teams away. Well, what the NBA, one, they don't like that, right? Because then that's free agency is not so free. Mm-hmm. And it's restricted free agency anyway. But what they did was they made it so if you're coming off that rookie scale deal, your cap hold is 300% of your prior salary. So Ingram, I said, right, 7.3 in change, you know, that's I'm rounding it. He's going to be on the books for $21.8 million as a cap hold in next summer, not the summer coming, but the summer after that. That wipes away, you know, that's $14 million extra dollars that you're jumping up there. They add that with all those other ones, and that tells a story, I think, that you were saying is you might not have the money, you know, unless you're saying, all right, well, we're done with Ingram. We're moving on from him. You know, and that's, you know, at that point, it's, you know, and obviously, you know, I'm assuming all the best for him and that he comes back healthy and is, you know, productive and ready to go and still a, you know, good young player. That now all of a sudden you're looking at it as like, well, you're just throwing him away. That's when you start to look, well, do you trade him in season if you're just going to dump him in the offseason anyway for cap space? You know, well, what do you do? And people will mention, well, sign and trades and all these things, but sign and trades are complicated. They're not easy. The player can't get as much as they wanted in other things. The player has to agree to it. This is what's happening with the Celtics right now. Celtics fans assume, well, they'll just put Terry Rozier in a sign and trade in a trade for Anthony Davis. Well, what if Rozier doesn't want to go to the Pelicans? You know, well, what if Ingram doesn't want to go to the Pelicans? Mm-hmm. What if he doesn't want to go anywhere else they want to trade him for? That gets really complicated, and that's where, you know, that's easy because, you know, well, I did it on NBA 2K. Well, yeah, okay, that's cool, but this is, you know, real life with real people, you know, so you're really going to think it through.
Yeah, 2K isn't real life, so unfortunately that doesn't quite work out. Sign and trades used to be really, really common, but the NBA has cut down on them because they didn't like the position that it was putting franchises in, where they felt like they had to do it in order to get something for the player. So they cut down on those. That's no longer an option in a lot of cases. But mentioning the Ingram thing, that's why I've been saying, look, the Lakers may, if they're convinced that he's going to come back, he's going to be 100% healthy, and that he's going to be able to hit the level of play that he did towards the few weeks before he got hurt, which is a really, really high level, then mm-hmm. they may want to seriously consider, if they've got all of their money spent this summer, extending him before the window closes. I believe it's usually on Halloween. It's the end of October. Yep. And they could go ahead and extend him and give him a new deal if it's less than that $21 million, because that would actually free up a little bit of room. Of course, you know, again, that's where they have to believe that he's their guy and he's the guy that they want to stick with, and they're going to put money on him. But the Warriors did something similar with Steph Curry when he had all of his ankle injuries. They signed him up, and because they got him for cheap because of the ankle injuries, they were then able to go and land pieces in the future like Kevin Durant and like all these other players that they've been able to amass.
And they had the benefit of the single biggest cap spike we've ever seen in the NBA. Now, one thing I do want to mention that could help the Lakers going in, not this summer, but going into the summer of 2020, the cap is expected to jump $7 million, which is, you know, that's not an insignificant amount. It is, you know, as of right now and off of the most recent projections the league has provided, it's $109 million projection for this summer, $116 for the summer after. So that is a big chunk. And I think that could, you know, could go a long way towards freeing some stuff up. Now, people will come back with, well, the max salary will rise by the same percent. Yeah, it'll rise by the same percent. But what doesn't rise is those numbers we talked about, like LeBron and Lonzo mm-hmm. and Brandon Ingram. Those all stay static. So that's where, you know, you could start to see things, you know, help in their benefit. So I just, you know, to get out of the math for a second, I just don't know that LeBron James is going to be amenable to saying, yeah, roll it over another year. I have a really hard time believing that. I just think, you know, I mean, he's going into year 17 right now, you know, if I'm correct. Yeah. Year 17 is what he's heading into. So I really think it's, you know, all right. And I'm not saying he's unhappy there by any means, but I think he's looking at it as, all right, hey, we had some stuff go on this year. I can, you know, write that off. I think, and probably if you could get him to really admit it, he's enjoying this break from basketball that he's had, you know, for the first time in, you know, I don't know, almost a decade and a half, I guess. It's you know, I think he's probably, you know, kind of getting it and understanding. And, you know, I personally think we might see LeBron come back in October and just kind of lay waste to the NBA and, you know, really just come out of the gates on fire. But it's but convincing him to say, hey, we're just going to roll it over and we're going to do the, you know, not that it'll be Rajon Rondo and Lance Stevenson, but we're going to do that again. I find that to be a really difficult conversation to have. And I'm not entirely sure that's what Frank Vogel signed up to coach either. So it'll be kind of interesting to see where that all goes.
Yeah, I don't think LeBron would be too thrilled with that outcome heading into this year's. I mean, we're already hearing that he's reaching out to guys like Kawhi, guys like Jimmy Butler. I think he is very much determined to go and find somebody.
Don't forget, he's liking Instagram posts with
that's right
Lakers jerseys, because it's that time of year where we gotta, you know, we all gotta follow everything that these guys do. And it's, you know, I can real quick, I want to tell a funny story.
Sure.
I was in the visitors locker room. I live in Orlando. I was in the visitors locker room a couple years ago, right before the trade deadline. This was when it was right around All-Star break, or right after the All-Star break. It was the year Cousins got traded during All-Star weekend.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yep. When they were in New Orleans.
Yeah, exactly. I was in the visitors locker room, and a player had come back from his pregame warm-ups, and we were, you know, you've milled around in there enough to know, like, sometimes guys want to talk, sometimes they don't pregame, you know, so you're just kind of getting what you can. And I saw a guy go, hey, watch this. And all he did was tweet 3 exclamation points. And because it was a week or two ahead of the trade deadline, oh my God, his phone blew up. And like crazy. Everybody's like, oh, what's going on? You're being traded. Who did you trade for? Did you get traded? All this stuff. And he's just sitting there laughing and nothing happened. He just did it to be, you know, to be a jerk, and, you know, because it was funny, and everybody in the locker room laughed, and I was like, man, people just go nuts this time of year. So, you know, yeah, it'd be just I never make too much of the random eye emoji tweets, or, you know, the let's go, or liking posts, or following and unfollowing guys. It's, you know, it's fun, and I get caught up in it too, but let's not go crazy.
It's like a whole other, I don't know, thing to itself where yeah, I mean, LeBron likes Kyrie Irving in a Lakers jersey. And next thing you know, Kyrie is a Laker, and this is happening and that's happening. And but yeah, I'd be doing the same thing if I was a player, though. I would send out just something random, something cryptic. I would pick something from like an old song or something like that and tweet that out and then just just watch the world burn. I mean,
I'd do something like, you know where I've always found a nice place? Portland. You know, and just watch, oh my God, he's going to Portland, you know, or something like that.
Yep. It would be an easy way to amuse yourself for a little bit. Keith, I do want to talk a little bit about Anthony Davis and what a move like that would look for, because a lot of Lakers fans have been asking, can the Lakers trade for AD and still sign one of those tier two max guys? So I do want to get into that. But first, quick shout out to our sponsor, betonline.ag. The NBA finals are underway and you've got the Raptors taking on the Warriors. Is your confidence high? Are you willing to place a wager? Don't know where to start? There's only one place to get in and all the action. Grab the odds and allow the experts at betonline.ag to do the heavy lifting for you. Sports, live betting, virtual casino, you name it. Betonline.ag is our preferred sportsbook online. If you're feeling lucky and would like to support our podcast, go to clnsmedia.com/LeBron. That's how they know that you came from us. And then use the promo code CLNS50 to get a 50% sign-up bonus. Again, that promo code is CLNS50. BetOnline.ag, your online sportsbook experts. All right, Keith. So obviously, the Lakers have been connected with Anthony Davis for a long, long time. There's a number of teams that are going to be pursuing him this summer. But a lot of people have been asking me, what happens if the Lakers trade for Anthony Davis? Can they still have enough space to go sign another max player if they say trade all the kids in order to get AD? What's that situation? I know order of events is going to matter here. Can you help us break all that down?
Yeah, absolutely. So I'm glad you mentioned it. Order of operations. This is one of my favorite things this summer. I sound like a math nerd. And trust me, I was not the kid you were asking for math help back in the day. But, you know, it is really important here because you got to sequence things the right way. So what I see is most likely is I think the trade would get agreed to at the NBA draft because we got to believe the fourth pick would be involved. I can't really see any way it would not be from the Lakers side going to the Pelicans. And at that point, obviously, the Lakers would draft for the Pelicans. We'd go through the charade of the kid wearing, you know, a Lakers hat and having to talk about playing with his, you know, hero growing up, LeBron James, and we're all kind of
like, it's so awkward. Why don't they change that? Every year we see this.
Yeah. Yeah, the reason why they don't change it is because it's not official yet,
right?
And that's the whole thing behind it. Why we don't just say like, "Hey, we're gonna skip the interview instead of making this kid look silly," you know? But it is what it is, and a lot of people say, "I don't rob the guy of, you know, his moment in the sun as a high draft pick and all that stuff." But yeah, you know, right? And then and we all snicker and laugh and be like, "You know, he's going to the Pelicans to play with Zion," so right. You know, which, hey, that's not a bad, you know, consolation prize. But anyway, so I believe it would be a agreed to at the draft, but then not executed until the moratorium is over in the first part of July, around, you know, July 4th, 5th, 6th, 7th, in that range, when the NBA, you know, basically says, all right, we've finalized all the cap numbers, here we go. Deals can now be consummated. The reason why I say that is because, again, we talked about it, right? The Lakers are going to want to, they're already tight on the margins, right, of creating that max cap space. So what you want to do is you want to get to that spot, go sign your Jimmy Butler or whoever it is, or Kyrie. Then you're going to take and start piling together the rest of your contracts you've got left to go and get Anthony Davis. And they've obviously got enough to go there to go do that. Now, you know, we can argue the value of, you know, do you put Ball, Hart, Ingram, Kuzma all in one deal with the fourth pick? I don't know. I think it's Anthony Davis. My answer is yes. You know, you do that, especially if you've got LeBron and somebody else. But, you know, so I know some people say, well, we got to hold Kuzma back or whatever. But that can all be figured out and debated. Sure. So I think your order of operations there would be agreed to at the draft, with knowledge of we're going to sign another max guy. You could also, then that's a recruitment tool, right? Of, hey, we've already got this deal agreed to with Anthony Davis, we're going to go get him. And now you've got LeBron, free agent X, and then you make the trade for Davis after that.
So is there the possibility for them to hang on to one of those young guys, or do all of those salaries have to go out in order for them to have enough room in order to bring in that tier two max guy? Because I was thinking it was the latter there. They would have to part with pretty much just about everybody in order to have enough space to do both.
Yeah, I'm looking at it right now.
I know it'll be close, though.
Well, so remember what we talked about at the beginning of the show in signing and waiting the 30 days?
Yep.
That could be the way you go. Because if you did Ball, Hart, Ingram, Kuzma, and Wagner, mm-hmm. You're at $21.9 million. So that gets you there if Davis agrees to waive his trade kicker. If he doesn't agree to waive his trade kicker, now what you're looking at is you would say, all right, well, then what we'll do is we'll take Kuzma or Hart likely, because you're still going to have Ball and Ingram in there because of the money. And then you sign the fourth pick, and then you do the trade and wait 30 days. So, unfortunately for Pelicans fans and Laker fans looking for Davis, you'll hear about it sometime in, what's the draft this year? June?
I think it's 20th?
20th or something like that. You'll hear about it then, and then it'll actually be executed sometime in, around my birthday in late July. So that's the kind of sad part. And then right when you're ready to shut it down and take a break, you'll have to be covering Anthony Davis press conferences. Right, it'll be that's the tough thing. And then you're going to be watching guys get sent off for the World Cup this summer and all that stuff. So those are your two options. You kind of go either way there of you sign the pick and wait the 30 days. And go that's where that $7 million really is kind of helpful, is in the salary matching there. So you can get there. The other option is, do you convince the Pelicans to do something like, I don't know, Mike Muscala, and give him a $3 million a year contract where only the first year is guaranteed in a sign and trade. That's what to go all the way back. That's what the Brooklyn Nets did when they traded for Kevin Garnett and Paul Pierce. Keith Bogans was given about a $5 million contract. That's where, right, only the first year was guaranteed, because in a sign and trade it has to be a minimum of 3 years, and the first year has to be fully guaranteed. If the Pelicans are trading Davis, no matter how much you may love Zion, they're rebuilding. There's no other way around it. So at that point, them eating, a guy like Muscala and the only reason I use him is because I don't think guys like Bullock or Caldwell Pope or those guys are going to want to go somewhere and play and be a part of things, where I think a guy like Muscala could say, I'll just take a paycheck, sure, and go that route. Because, and let's face it, he's probably not going to get that much money from anybody this summer anyway.
Sure.
So I think that's where you could work that way. So that's a super, super duper long way of answering. You can get there. You've got a couple different options to get there, but it is going to wipe out most of the kids.
Yeah, it would. It would have to, just in order to have enough room. By the way, I looked it up. The draft is indeed June 20th. So that's a Thursday. That's going to be draft day for the NBA. You know what you were mentioning, though, Mike Muscala signing a contract and then just kind of collecting a paycheck. That reminds me of how it used to be years ago. If you remember, Keith Van Horn got thrown into a trade after he had not officially retired, obviously, but he had stopped playing, and he got thrown into a trade, got a new contract. Aaron McKee for the Lakers, same thing happened, where these guys got signed to these contracts just to match salaries. They would sign them to a deal, then ship them out. They would never play a minute, and they'd collect a nice big paycheck. Not a bad way to head into your retirement, that's for sure.
And I may be off, but I want to say Aaron McKee might have been an assistant coach at like Temple or something at the time when that happened, that which was right. A whole, bananas thing that happened there. And then that worked out with Van Horn. Now that's one where the NBA, again, we keep coming back to this whole idea of closing loopholes. They closed a loophole mm-hmm. there where you can only sign and trade a player who was on your roster the previous season. So, so these guys, could retire, their cap hole could sit on your books for, for a number of years, but you can't do anything with it. You can only sign and trade somebody who played for you in the previous year. So Muscala obviously qualifies, as does, any one of the Lakers free agents, I think, and that's just at that point, you're making math work there and giving a guy a payday that he's never going to get otherwise.
Right. Right. And again, if you're that guy and you get that call out of the blue, if you were Aaron McKee and you get that call saying, hey, you want to go make however much he made, it was a solid chunk of money. You want to go make a little bit of money just to show up in a city for half a day and then take off. Yep.
Show up, take a physical. And, exactly. If anybody says anything, you're dealing with a personal situation.
So, Keith, I want to wrap up with this. And this is something we mentioned at the very beginning. The timing, this is something that gets brought up every year. Should the draft actually occur after free agency? I'm looking at the Lakers' position and thinking, gosh, if they knew whether or not they were getting free agents, and maybe they will through some back channeling and things like that, but if they knew for sure, hey, we didn't sign anybody, Okay, we didn't get Kyrie, we didn't get Kemba, we didn't get Jimmy Butler, none of those guys. We didn't get any of them. Then I think that changes their strategy with their number four overall pick, whereas having the draft first, you can't really draft for need because you don't know what you're getting in free agency, and that's, you know, for all teams, and you also can't figure out what you're going to do with that pick for sure for a team in the Lakers situation. Do you make a move to win now and then it comes back to bite you because you don't land any free agents and then you kind of missed the opportunity to land a prospect that you can add to your young core? I don't know. I think there's some real pros and cons to it, but what do you think about flipping the draft and the free agent period?
So this is something I have spent a lot longer than I really care to admit thinking about. And I've thought about it in the context of how we could reform the draft mm-hmm. as a whole and not have the lottery work the way it works. I like the idea of every year, each team, each thing works on a 5-year cycle. And it's not the wheel approach, but everything works on a 5-year cycle where each team is given as many as, you know, 10 chances, which could be, you know, ping pong balls, whatever you want to call them, in a lottery. And then you could trade chances. So if you wanted to trade 5 chances, you know, for a guy, then the team getting him, now they have 15 chances in the upcoming draft or something along mm-hmm. those lines. And I've thought about this a lot. So, you know, but that's something I can, you know, maybe somewhere put pen to paper and talk about down the line. But to answer your question is, I think there is something to it. I think the biggest challenge you have is the vast majority of guys who come into the NBA as rookies who are drafted don't have a huge impact. They come in as projects, and you're not using that. It's not like you're looking at it and saying, all right, so, man, we signed a great center in the – let's say the Lakers, you know, was that way, and they're like, hey, we signed Nick Vucevic. You know, now we've got our center spot locked down, so instead of a center, we're going to draft a wing. But the next best guy at 4, which isn't really – picked a really poor example. All right, let me redo this. Let's say they signed Jimmy Butler.
Start over.
Last thing we need is another wing, right? We don't need another wing. So we're going to draft Jackson Hayes, the top center prospect. Well, I don't think you're going to jump Hayes up 6 spots because he fits your roster better. Because I think the NBA, especially in the draft, unless you're really got spots filled and a guy is, you know, he's 1 and 1A on your board, you might go with 1A because he fits better positionally. It's all about collecting the best player available. So that's where, you know, don't worry too much about how you actually draft guys. Where I do like it, though, is the idea of, all right, hey, we know we have a trade for Anthony Davis, so we either need to use the pick in that trade, or, hey, can we use this pick to trade for somebody else at the draft to come in and, you know, and with the salary matching, you know, go get ourselves another $7, $8 million player, you know, that way or something like that. That's where I like it. You know, and it's, I know a lot of people mention, well, that's how it works in the NFL, but I think the NFL draft is very different from the NBA draft. It's, you know, obviously bigger, and it's, you know, there's 7 rounds, and, you know, it seems like multiple teams come away with, you know, 8, 9, 10 guys every year, when the NBA teams at most might add 3 or 4 guys. 3 is even the max of what anybody wants to add rookie wise on one team. So yeah, it's tough. I don't have a huge problem with it the way it is, but I can see all the reasons for changing it and moving it.
It would be an interesting switch just to see how it would all play out. Obviously, it's something that they would have to really, really consider because it's been this way for quite a while, and something that that we're all used to. But just looking at things, you know, yeah, you don't really draft for need too much, or at least you shouldn't. Look, if you're drafting in the, say what, if you're drafting in the lottery and you're drafting for fit, I think you're making a mistake.
Yeah, that's probably why you're drafting in the lottery.
Right, that's why you're drafting in the lottery. If you're drafting for fit in those top, you want to just take overall talent. I'm a big proponent of that. You take the best player regardless of what the fit is. Even if you have a great point guard and the best player is a point guard, you take him. But still, I could see where there would be some benefits, and specifically just looking at the Lakers situation, I think it would help them out a little bit. But yeah, I mean, something that's been kicked around every now and then, and who knows, maybe it's something they'll come back to. It does seem like the league right now is more open to tweaking things than we've seen at various points in the past. I mean, as we said, they just decided to move up the start of free agency, which makes a whole lot of sense. And now that they've done it, it's kind of like, man, why didn't they do this a long time ago?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I mean, this is one of those things where, you know, it's funny. I saw some, you know, lamenting, and I agree, and, you know, to an extent of, I mean, I miss that whole, like, you know, putting the family to bed, and, you know, I'm sitting down with, you know, I got my Gatorade, and I'm ready to go at midnight, you know, and I know I'm up for the next 3 hours or so, and then I'm a complete mess the next day and useless. There is something we said, especially in the Twitter age. But you know what? All we're going to do is now we're going to make that at 6 p.m, and that's fine. You know, I don't have any problem with that. 3 p.m. for you guys on the West Coast. Like, all right, let's go. You know, it's, now it'll be interesting what happens when it's not a weekend day. You know, then I wonder, did you maybe make it 8 o'clock so at least people are clear of work?
Right.
Hopefully. So that'll be curious to see, you know, where it goes. But I think your bigger point there is an important one. I think Adam Silver, one of the things I like most about him is he's not married to any of these things. I think he is very progressive and says if enough fans want it, teams want it, players want it, then there's something here that we need to take a look at to make our league, you know, the best possible league it can be. And you have to love that. You have to love and respect that. Because at the end of the day, whether you're a fan of the Lakers or any other team, what you really want is the NBA to be, you know, as good as it can possibly be.
Yeah, and I think there's a real argument to be made that the NBA, and for a lot of fans, they enjoy the offseason just as much, if not more, than the regular season. It's becoming an even bigger event every single year. And this year is going to be crazy with all the top tier free agents that are going to be out there. So why not? Why not push this to a time when more people can be active and be there for it? Then, you know, you can't ask everyone to be up at 2 a.m. waiting to see if their team signed Kemba Walker or something like that. You know, by pushing it earlier, I think it makes a whole lot of sense. It's going to generate more publicity for the league, and it's going to generate more sleep for me. So from a selfish perspective, I'll take it. That's for sure.
Yeah, man, I'm hoping by the time we hit midnight, like, things are winding down and I can actually just go to bed and be like, all right, cool, I can go to bed at, you know, the time I generally go to bed at. And then, you know, those handful of deals that maybe break, I'll catch them in the morning versus having to be up until, as you said, you know, 2, 3, 4 in the morning, you know, local time. And then it's like, her, what are we doing? And then, of course, every time then when you're all geared up for that, that's when you get those one or two summers where it's, not to bring up bad memories, but it's like, first deal that breaks is Timofey Mozgov.
Oh,
it's like, wait, what? Why? Why were they at his house at midnight? You know, and I saw, I want to say it was the Kaminsky brothers, who I think are LA-based radio team. One of them tweeted,
the Cambros, you know, yep.
Yeah, well, when I put out, hey, this is the best thing to happen to free agency in years. One of the guys put in, he goes, and players don't have to eat steak dinners at 12:01 in the morning. And I was like, that's a good point too. You know, I didn't really think about that one. So yeah, I think it's a good change. You know, if nothing else, we try it. Maybe it doesn't work, and, you know, maybe they move it back and say, all right, 8 o'clock works or something like that. But I think for at least this year, it's going to be, you know, it's a great thing to try, and you know, like I said, going back to it, trying stuff. That's the, you know, the best part of this whole thing.
Yep, it's going to be a fun day, and I really think, just to finish up here, I really think that there needs to be something, some sort of an alert that goes out when Woj and Shams and whoever else and all the other newsbreakers, when they're all calling it a night, there needs to be something, like something that goes out to let everybody know it's okay to sleep now, because gosh, yes. I'm always worried. I'm going to go to sleep and then something's going to break. So hopefully there needs to be some sort of signal, a Woj signal or something like that, that lets everyone know that, hey, no more news is coming out tonight. Go ahead and shut it down, but be ready tomorrow.
Man, that is the best idea I think I've ever heard. Yeah, it's it. I'm shutting the phone off. I'm going to bed.
That's it.
You know, unfortunately, that would make all of them have to. You know, you're at that point. You're, what do they call it? A Mexican standoff where everybody's got the guns pointed at each other. Because you're going to have to. It's almost like the draft picks last year, right? Where it's like, all right, well, we all won't break draft picks, and then Mark Stein's like, I'm breaking draft picks. You know, and then all of a sudden you got Woj with what, you know, his thesaurus out of, you know, breaking things, and then Shams eventually like, guys, I gotta get in on this, I can't, you know, be the only dude hanging out. So yeah, it's you know, the level of coordination to get them all to trust each other, I think that would be pretty funny.
That was the subplot of the draft, was Woj saying, you know, oh, the the Grizzlies intend to select this player or that
zeroing in on selecting
this player. It's like, oh God. So look, here's what would really happen if we did that, if we implemented some sort of across the board, this is the drop dead point, Woj and Shams and everybody's shutting off their phones. You would wind up with Woj and Shams would somehow wind up in the same place at the same time, just staring at each other, waiting for the other one to fall asleep. So they start firing off
texts and tweets.
And I would pay to see that. I think they should stream that somehow. Okay, we took a far turn here, Keith.
we got away from the outline of the show, but that's the fun of it, right?
That's all right. Good times. Any final thoughts? Anything that you have coming up as we're heading into the draft and free agency? I'm sure you have a ton of content planned. What do you want to let people know about?
Yeah, for your fans specifically, I just finished the Lakers offseason preview for Real GM. I promise I did not spend the whole time like a lot of our brethren in the media have done of taking a bunch of shots at the team. I just don't find a lot of interest in that. It's, you know, it's not, now I want to see it's about what happens now going forward. So I just wrote about that. There's, you know, we all kind of know what the stories are here and what the paths are forward for the Lakers. So, you know, I'm curious to see which one actually comes to play. So that'll be out later this week at some point. A bunch more off-season previews. I'm about a third of the way through those. So those will continue to come out all the way up until June 30th, I guess now. My deadline got moved up a day. At Real GM, we'll have all those out. I've got some stuff in the works with Yahoo. I don't think we're really ready to talk about it just yet. But, you know, if you like the work that I do, it's based around that. And, seeing some things put out there that maybe aren't readily accessible resources, I guess that's probably as much as I should probably say. And then that's about it for right now. That's what we got going on. Celtics blog. I ran through a whole bunch of situations for the Celtics this summer with a lot of cap detail and roster stuff. So if anybody's interested in just understanding a little more how these things could work and play out, that's out there as well over at Celtics blog.
All right, fair enough, guys. And make sure you go follow Keith at KeithSmithNBA on Twitter. Tons of great information, all kinds of salary cap info. Make sure you go give him a follow on there. That's going to wrap things up for today. Don't forget, guys, head over to LakersNation.com, your home for everything Lakers. And head over to iTunes, rate, review, and subscribe to this show. Let us know what you think about the show. Toss us a review. We always appreciate it, especially when we get those 5-star ratings coming in, because that helps us out. That helps the show. So again, if you wouldn't mind doing that, we would certainly appreciate it. Again, head over to iTunes, rate, review, and subscribe. And of course, don't forget to follow us on social media. You can follow us on Twitter and Facebook at Lakers Nation, on Instagram at Lakers Nation Official, and check out the Lakers Nation YouTube page where I'm doing all kinds of different live video content now. We do have the Lakers Nation show where Jas Kang and I come on and we break down everything else that's going on in the world of the Lakers. You get to comment. It's a live show, so I take comments from fans and we get to interact, so that's a lot of fun. And then we also have the news feed shows where anything that breaks, we discuss that on there. So make sure you go check that out over on the Lakers Nation YouTube channel, which has been doing phenomenal lately. And I'm so proud of the work that myself and the other people for Lakers Nation, especially Daryl Ann, our videographer, are doing over there. And of course, if you guys want to follow me on Twitter, you can find me at Trevor_Lane. Till next time, see ya.